Hello, dear viewers. What you're looking at here is a Hewlett Packard Proliant ML150 G6, and for all intents and purposes, it is e-waste. With a pair of socket 1366 Xeons, it consumes a silly amount of power, while providing so little single-core performance that a cheap 6th or 7th Gen i5 can run circles around it. It doesn't even support the newer 6-core CPUs that kept servers like the Dell R710 relevant for so long, meaning the multi-core performance isn't great either. So why is it here on the table instead of in the bin? That's because if we ditch this old motherboard, we're left with a surprisingly good 8-bay case that we're going to have a go at reusing. In terms of features, the ML150 has the aforementioned 8 hot-swappable drive bays in the front and a pair of 750-watt power supplies in the back. But, I hear you ask, how could we possibly use those drive bays? It's a HP. Don't they have proprietary power connectors? Well, yes, many of them do, but not here. No, that's just a pair of regular Molex connectors on each backplane, along with two SFF 8087 SAS connectors. This shouldn't be surprising though, since any half-decent server would use standard connectors and pinouts anyway. There's a couple other good things going on here too. The motherboard tray supports standard mounting layouts for a variety of form factors. The I/O shield isn't integrated into the case, meaning we can easily replace it. And we can reuse one of the 750-watt power supplies, but with a few caveats, primarily that we can't use both for redundancy. Most of this likely isn't particularly surprising to anyone familiar with hardware like this, but I do think it does present an interesting option for a budget home server case, and I really do mean budget. The entire ML150 here cost me the equivalent of about $8. The first thing we're going to take a closer look at is the power supply situation. This system had two main options when new, either a non-redundant, non-hot-swappable 360-watt power supply, or a pair of hot-swappable, redundant 750-watt power supplies, the latter of which this system has. There are also 460-watt common slot power supplies that should work fine in place of the 750s, and there seems to be a 1200-watt option as well, but I absolutely cannot confirm whether that higher wattage option is compatible. Those other options don't appear to have shipped with the ML150, rather being options for other systems, like the ML350 G6, but since they all use the same slot, it may be an option worth considering. The 750-watt option is generally considered to be a decent power supply, considering it claims 92% efficiency, which isn't bad if that figure is accurate. The 460-watt option isn't as good, though. For this, however, the non-redundant power supply is the preferable option, since it makes installing a new one much easier. While the case itself isn't compatible with the screw hole layout of an ATX power supply, since the opening on the back is the wrong shape and size, the non-redundant power supply option ships with a bracket to adapt what is effectively a standard power supply to this case. While I don't have one myself, images I found on the internet, as well as in the official service manual, suggest that the bracket should fit any regular ATX power supply, because the screw layout appears to be correct. I can't confirm that will actually work, because I don't have that version of the system, but there are options either way though, including using the original redundant setup, which is what I'm going to do. Basically, however, if you have the non-redundant option, just unscrew the power supply, leave the bracket in the case, and install a new one of your choosing. The redundant power supplies are plugged into this backplane here, which converts their 12-volt output into all the other voltages the system needs, as well as actually turning on the power supplies and swapping between them when one fails. However, unlike the vast majority of other HP and HPE servers, it has a regular ATX power connector. We won't be able to use both for redundancy, since we aren't able to automatically switch between them without the original motherboard, and we also can't use them both at once for a combined 1500 watts, but that is a limitation of the backplane. Still, even though we can only use one, I think it's still quite decent. So, to make one of the two power supplies work, I first removed the entire housing and backplane assembly from the case. It's screwed in at the back, but there's also an internal screw that's easy to miss. Here, we have the ATX 24-pin connector, with this green wire coming out of it and connecting to what is effectively an extension on this definitely very non-standard cable, which is the RPS cable, that connects to the system's original motherboard. To make this work, we need to keep this extension cable because we're going to bridge two pins on it. But first, we should go over how this works. When first researching this backplane, I found a forum post that suggested that bridging two pins on the RPS power supply cable, not the extension, would work, and that was mostly true. Unfortunately, this method of turning the power supply on inadvertently ends up connecting some things that aren't meant to be connected, which does turn the power supply on so we can use it, but it also forces the motherboard to turn on, at which point it can't be powered off because it will immediately turn back on after shutting down or resetting. That isn't a real solution, so to figure out a better method, I got out my multimeter and made a few assumptions that do seem like they were correct. Since the extension cable connected one of the wires in the RPS cable to the PS on wire on the 24-pin connector, that's the green one, it seemed logical that the modular power supplies must use effectively the same principle to power on. With a normal ATX power supply, the motherboard connects the green PS on wire to ground, and since that wire is connected to a rail within the power supply that is always powered, even if the system is off, provided it's plugged into a power outlet which is switched on, it can therefore be used to signal the power supply to turn on, in turn turning the motherboard on. And by connecting this cable to the ATX connector, it therefore probably does something similar for these HP redundant power supplies. That doesn't work on its own with these HP power supplies though, and that's because the original motherboard does extra work when it signals the power supply to turn on. So, when we bridge what I assume is the equivalent of the PS on wire to the wire for the bottom power supply slot, it turns on, but then can't be turned off and isn't controlled correctly by the motherboard. That's because even though it partially works, it isn't right. Instead, we need to keep the extension cable for the connection to the PS on wire in the ATX connector and bridge two wires on the end of the extension. Obviously, this would also work without the extension, but would require more effort, and since we still have it, it's pretty easy to just adapt it. Aside from the original forum post, which I now unfortunately can't locate, pointing me in a slightly right, but mostly wrong direction, I figured most of this out by just testing everything with a multimeter until I figured out how to make it work. I don't know for sure why it works though, so my explanation is almost entirely speculation. I'm not an expert on these HP power supplies, so keep in mind that I could be completely wrong about why it works, even though it still obviously does. Also, if you do this, you do it at your own risk. I don't know how this setup will fare long term, since it absolutely was not designed to be used in this way. Anyway, I made this diagram to show which two pins need to be connected together. After testing it to make sure it worked, we need to make it more permanent and less janky. Firstly, I put some heat shrink tubing over the connector for the PS on signal, since it doesn't fit very well and I don't want it to come apart. I only burnt the heat shrink tubing just a little bit with my lighter. Next, I cut the two appropriate wires off from the extension cable, soldered them together, and used heat shrink tubing to prevent shorts. There's no need to remove the wires from the end of the extension since they're now not connected to anything. With that done, we can now only use one power supply, but it does provide a very reasonable 750 watts, and in the case it fails, I do have a spare, although replacing it will result in downtime since there's no redundancy here. With the system upright and the power supply backplane installed, the usable slot is the bottom one. I would suggest removing the second power supply from the upper slot since we won't be using it. While this is overall a somewhat complicated solution, for the price I paid, it seems acceptable to me. If soldering isn't your thing, using a conventional power supply is definitely a better option, and if you have the non-redundant setup, it should be very easy with the included bracket. Now, it's time to put this together, and for that we need a motherboard. I'm not doing a real build here, just demonstrating the case, so basically any board will do. Why am I mentioning that? Because if I don't, someone will inevitably leave a comment telling me that the board is too old and I shouldn't use it, even though this system will most likely be completely disassembled right after I finish filming, and I will not, in fact, be using it. So then, we're going with this ASUS board with an AMD A4 3400 processor and 4 GB of whatever memory I happen to find. A good option for a build in this case would, I think, be either a cheap X99 board, if you want lots of cores, or a second-hand Socket 1151 motherboard for better power efficiency with a newer, but lower core count processor. Next, we need a SAS, HBA, and a pair of SAS cables. We'll use this IBM M5110 that was pre-flashed to IT mode when I bought it roughly 5 years ago, and has a small fan mounted to it. It's a decent card that I've been using in my own server for a while and have never had any issues with, although there are definitely better options available now since this card is quite old. When testing this, I wasn't able to get the option ROM for the card to show up with this motherboard, but I think the board itself might have been misbehaving because it all still worked with no other issues. Now we need a hard drive to test the backplane, so I'm going with this 3TB Seagate drive. Again, I'm not doing a real build here, just demonstrating this case, and I would be foolish to use a 3TB Seagate drive long term. And here it is, installed in a drive tray. These trays are fine once the drives are installed, but unlike the comparable Dell trays, which are metal, these plastic HP ones are quite flimsy and really aren't that great. The motherboard screw layout is completely standard, and the motherboard tray is very thoroughly labeled as supporting micro ATX, regular ATX, EATX, SSITEB, and SSICEB, all of which is great. Too bad EATX isn't real and doesn't exist. In terms of cooling, the easiest thing to do is replace the original fans, as well as getting rid of the airflow shroud because it won't really do much. The front fans are all 92mm and the rear fan is 120mm. I don't have a 120mm fan lying around at the moment because the last one I had left over from the most recent pack of 5 I bought went straight into my own PC, so we're just going to pretend that I replaced the one in this case. The front fans are installed in these blue plastic mounts, of which there's support for up to 3. I only have one of them, and there's 2 types. 2 of them, which fit in the labelled slots for fan 1 and 2, have a slightly different mounting clip to the one for fan 3, and I only have the one for fan 3. In case you're not sure what I'm talking about, the locations for the fans are labelled, but it isn't very visible on camera. The difference is that the fan 3 bracket includes PCIe card alignment guides, which no one ever uses, so it doesn't fit underneath this shroud, which we got rid of anyway. The actual holes in the motherboard tray that they slot into are the same, it's just the clip at the top is different. So, I replaced the fan and then mounted the fan holder in the fan 1.5 slot, which is between the fan 1 and 2 slots, and then just used a small zip tie to secure it at the top. My solution is kind of janky, but if I actually had the other fan brackets, it wouldn't be an issue at all. Also, keep in mind that with newer hardware and a CPU cooler fan, there's very little to worry about with keeping the CPU cool. We really just need the front fans to keep the hard drive base cool. To replace the old fans, carefully lift the clips on each side and extract them from the housing. When installing new fans, slide them into the mount until they clip into place, being careful to route the cable correctly. The rear fan is easier as it is held in with 2 screws, with metal tabs in the other 2 holes for alignment. Finally, the front panel connector. In addition to a power button, this server had 4 front indicator lights and a temperature sensor. I say had because I removed them all with the intention of rewiring and reusing the original power button, which is a completely viable way of going about it. This didn't go to plan for me, however, because I broke it. However, we don't need the original power button, and there's a better option anyway. What we're going to do is just replace the lock with a completely new switch. Why the lock? Because with it removed, there's a convenient hole for mounting literally anything else, and unlike some other models, the front panel isn't reliant on the lock to stay on the case, and instead just uses clips like a normal PC case. To finish this then, I bought a push button switch from my local electronics component retailer, soldered a pair of wires onto it, and mounted it in the front panel. I don't know exactly what size this switch is, but I had to adjust the size of the hole with a file because it was still slightly too large. With that done, however, it fits nicely and I think looks quite alright. The actual component, the switch, cost roughly $2. The reason I'm not going to go over this in much detail is because, one, it isn't a great solution, and two, if you do go with this, it's really easy. Just solder the wires to the switch, plug them into the motherboard. Switches like these don't have a polarity, you just connect them up. However, you are able to purchase pre-wired power buttons on sites such as eBay, which may provide a more convenient solution, and some of them come with an LED in them. And there we have it, a completed, albeit basic, build in the ML150 G6 case. Now, in Windows 10, I've opened up the disk management to demonstrate the backplanes. With the drive installed, we can see it listed here, but now I can remove it and it's gone. I can then slide it straight back into the slot, refresh the disk management, and it appears again with no issues. So, it works just fine. This shouldn't be surprising at all, but it does clearly demonstrate that the backplanes are usable and potentially even quite useful. So, the final verdict. Is this a good budget home server case? Yes, but only if you get it really cheap, just like I did with this one, since I paid the equivalent of roughly $8. There are definitely other cases available, both new and secondhand, with better build quality that are more space efficient and may have support for more drives. But if you're on a budget, I honestly think this or something similar is a pretty good option. To be clear though, it is only a good deal if it is cheap. I would not personally pay more than $20 for the entire system, and that's only if it has both drive cages and their backplanes, as well as all of the drive trays, and at least two front fans. The ML150 isn't the only system that I think would be worth considering for a build like this, since there is also the effectively identical ML330 G6, which appears to be the same case, but with a different motherboard. There are a few other models, mostly from older generations, that are also similar in the sense that they're basically just PC cases, but your mileage may vary. Rack models such as the DL180 G6 may also be acceptable since they use the same power supply backplane, but would likely require significantly more work to reuse. The ML150, however, is a good option once you get rid of that almost 15-year-old motherboard, and if you don't mind it being a little bit janky. In terms of it being janky, it's not too bad in my opinion. The power supply situation isn't perfect because it is more complicated than just installing a brand new standard power supply, but it's not bad for the price, and it does work correctly, as it should. I wouldn't have made this video if the power supply wasn't fully functional, especially since the previously accepted method for powering them on doesn't work correctly. The power button isn't great either, since it required a bit of work, but the actual parts only cost a couple dollars. The reason I'm willing to put up with a bit of jank here is because it cost almost nothing, and for that provides 8 drive bays with hot swap capable backplanes. Obviously, it won't be right for everyone, but I like it. Thanks for watching. I'll see you all next time.